Hey guys, good evening. We have a special guest today, Soha. She is joining us from Hyderabad. She is a mental health architect and also a coach. She is an on-demand speaker. She's been doing a lot of activities around the colleges. She is also doing corporate events, and she focuses mostly on the woman empowerment. And she believes that there are a lot of challenges around women still existing in the corporate, and it is not easy job. So this is her specialization, and you know, she's done she's got a lot of fan following. There are a lot of students who actually take help of her in terms of mental health, or you know, anytime they feel depressed or you know, stressed. So it's an honor to have you here, Soha. So can you introduce yourself to our new friends, and thanks for being here to become a new friend for us.
Thank you so much. A very warm good evening to everybody. And as Ravi said, I'm Soha Juneja. And you know, this being a Tuesday, we all going through a lot of chaos in life, coming out of it and fighting it out. I welcome everybody and congratulate everybody to, you know, live this life with pandemic and being so positive about it. So happy Tuesday to everybody. And to talk a little about myself, you know, I have a background of being a mental health advisor. I'm a counselor. I am a health coach, and I probably also am a happiness coach. Apart from that, I very strongly believe in, you know, that what really lights fire in my heart is the heart and the guts is to make a difference in someone's life. You know, I should say that I love uncovering what makes people tick or use it as a fuel for creating a mission, you know. So I very strongly believe that there should be a revolution in people's life, and people should be focusing on. And being a women entrepreneur, I very, very strongly believe that we shouldn't be having any discrimination, is what I realized when I was growing up. Because, you know, nobody held me from being a woman or telling me or making me realize that I'm a girl. Because it was always said that you know, though you are a girl, you live a life of, you know, a man and a woman together. So it's like, I'd always believe that I'm a sexist and I should probably be supporting men and women together. I very strongly believe that it is just not about the women empowerment, but it is about empowering beings together. So whether it is a man or a woman, I think we should empower each other and help and support each other.
True. Very true, very true. Well said, Soha, because, you know, it doesn't make sense, you know, just taking side of one gender and, you know, trying to increase or decrease. I think, you know, we have both equal roles to play in this particular world. And, you know, the best way is possible to go hand in hand. So
absolutely.
Good.
So it's a very strong belief that, you know, I mean, being upbringing, getting, you know, kind of... I think support from the family was the most important part. And when I was growing amongst five men, my father and his four brothers. So there were no women. He did not have sisters, and neither the other four men, that is my chachos, have had any daughters. So, you know, it was all men in the family. Later part, of course, you know, we had the women again coming in and all. But then I think I've lived with certain terms and norms that it's just not about man earning. And, you know, it's just not about we completely just being dependent on men, but also sometimes supporting them, walking shoulder in shoulder, holding hand, and, you know, telling them that sometimes they can also stay back home and rest, because women can actually work too. And that's the only reason that, you know, the strong persona had come out in a way that the fate seemed to be very powerful, with a lot of failures, of course. Life wasn't very easy though.
So how was your journey? I mean, you know, how did you come to coaching, and, you know, especially focusing on women empowerment and also mental health?
Well, women empowerment and mental health came in hand when I probably got married. I got married at a very, very young age. You know, by the time I realized that marriage happened, I already had a daughter with me. So, you know, bread and butter had become very difficult for me, because the kind of, you know, family I belonged to and the person I got married to, you know, we were completely abandoned from the family for a while. So bread and butter was very, very important, and I thought that I should start working and making my bread and butter. I did not even complete my graduation by then, so it was very, very difficult to get into penetrate into the market, even for getting a job. Though at that time jobs weren't very difficult like the way they are today, but then yes, so women entrepreneurship, helping women came through this, that I felt that every individual woman should actually go out to understand what's her potential, rather than just staying back home and cooking for the family. Of course, I understand that a woman is a 24-hour working woman, whether it is in the family or outside the family, but making money was definitely a challenge for me. So I very strongly believe that I should focus on making money and also focus on the family together. So yeah. And then mental health came when I probably was going through depression myself. So I very strongly believed that I had to probably work out, and I had to probably get into understanding
Come out
what's
of.
people's status at that point in time, is why people are getting into depression, because I was into very deep depression myself.
Yeah, I think that's the basic requirement. I think we were discussing this yesterday also. So one has to come through those challenges. Somebody cannot say that I'm a coach, I can work on mental health, where they had a life with silver spoon and without any challenges. They will have no idea about what hunger means, what depression means. So a person cannot talk about it if he's not experienced it.
But I think today, as individuals, I'm seeing that there are so many people abroad who are actually facing this and really, really troubled by this word depression. Either they do not understand whether they are actually depressed. There are certain habits that you can find out that a person is in depression. So that's quite an alarm. And we need to find out if a person is, like, yesterday and day before, we've been hearing a news, and that's making like round in every social media. And we are just wondering what might have happened with the gentleman. I wouldn't like to, take anybody's name, but yeah, we all know Sushant Singh Rajput. So yeah, I very, very strongly feel that one needs to open up and talk it out, because it is okay not to be okay at times. And that's absolutely fine. You can actually venture out, you can talk it out. When I was into depression, I was the one who was actually trying to talk it out with every single person I met, trying to tell them that I'm, very low, I'm not very happy about life, life doesn't seem to be happening, it's very challenging, I'm really not becoming famous, trying very hard, but things are really not working my way. And I was very, very deep down getting into these thoughts that why things aren't happening the way I want them to happen. So I was also getting into depression, because I was really struggling hard, and those were the days, I was getting into my young age, I should say, though I was married, but I was still, trying to work out on a lot of different streams, and things weren't happening my way. I wanted to become successful, because that was the story of the family around, everywhere, all the neighbors, relatives, friends, family, everybody started saying that once you become successful is when happiness actually would come into your life. But that wasn't the reality.
I agree with you. I mean, some of these things, I think one of the reason we do not, I mean, we are having these challenges are we hesitate to ask help. We hesitate to ask help because people, will think otherwise. We hesitate to ask help when we are financially low. We do not want to ask friends saying that, hey, I am in need, temporarily support me. And on the other side, we are also not prepared to support others when they are when they need financial support. I think it goes both way. One, asking for help, and in terms of support, shoulder support and financial support. I was also hearing, an auto driver, committed suicide because, there are lockdown and, he was not getting, he was not able to earn something for the family and he committed suicide. He would have approached somebody, he would have asked financial help. So I think somewhere, this is within all of us. It's not we are pinpointing out somebody, but I think within ourselves, we are not able to get that help. What you're saying is it's okay to say it's not okay. So, when somebody calls, I mean, if Soha calls Ravi, I shouldn't be always giving a rosy picture saying that, hey, Soha, it's perfectly right. I'm, you know, this is going great. Life is going great. I'm well settled and all that. Instead of that, if I have issues, I think I have to open up with Soha saying that, Soha, things are good, but this is not working out. I think I need help.
I very strongly think, Ravi, that people are not reaching out for money. Because they feel that, you know, and we people, I do not know if it is only in India or it is across the globe. But then as soon as somebody is asking you for financial help, you take a back, you know, it's like a sabbatical. Yeah. People do not want to help, support, and they discourage the person by saying that, you know, I mean, why is he coming for help? Maybe he's in trouble. Arey Baba, we shouldn't help him. Even if we have money in our closet, just kept into the cupboard and do not want to help anybody and support anybody. I think it is absolutely fine if somebody can reach out in asking for some financial help. Why does one have to judge a person just because he's asking for finances? And why can't we actually, I do not know if I'm trying to be very simple and very nice here, but then the reality is that I feel that we should reach out to people even for financial aid. And there is no harm if he is not able to get aid from one person. At least, you know, you go to 2-3 people, maybe somebody would help, you never know.
Right.
See, I know, you know, there are a lot of issues with the bankers. We do not happen to go into them because at the nth moment when we need money, bankers take their own sweet time to, you know, shell out that money and reach out to you and say, okay, fine, you are eligible for this loan. But then, I mean, it happened with me too. I should actually say this. I happened to ask from all my friends and family, and everybody deprived me of even being. They deprived me of relationship. They did not want to hear me, did not want to be connected with me. In fact, they kept me far away till a very, very long time, and then till success actually hit the doors. So failure is something which is very, very, you know, I mean, though I feel I welcome failure because I feel that teaches you life. But I'd seen people reaching out for money and, you know, people are so scared of them that they do not want to help them. But I feel that we should actually give that support also. Maybe if we are not able to give it in lakhs, not in thousands, at least in hundreds. You know, a bit of, I think, a drop by drop makes an ocean. So, yeah, why not? In fact, you know, I tell that there are a lot of programs where people actually get into doing charity.
Hmm.
That's very funny. I mean, you have your own family members suffering and people are going out, venturing out in charity. That's very strange. Why not help that particular family member in their trouble? Yeah, I remember, you know, when my daughter was like 3 or 4 years old and I had to, you know, take an admission in the school. Trust me, Ravi, that time, you know, I was just earning like peanuts. And I reached out to one of my neighbors saying I need, you know, 20,000 because I need to probably give a donation in the school and I do not have that money. How do I go about it? And she immediately happened to give it in my hand saying, okay, well, you know, it's okay. I mean, it's about your daughter's school and please go ahead. I did not want to go to my relatives and anybody at that point in time because, you know, that was a moment of, you know, I've got married and I'm going to my life. I do not want anybody to support me from the family, blah, blah, blah. So, yeah, I reached out and I did get the help. And today, I mean, you know, I mean, we are having a very healthy relationship. We are growing together and having that bond of, you know, supporting each other whenever need be.
Yes.
And today, if they are in help of money, I'm open and I would love to, in fact, anytime.
Exactly. I mean, I think Deepika also agrees with what you're saying. And, you know, we have Bhavna who's also saying, Log kya kahenge is the biggest taboo in our society.
Right.
So
right.
That's, I think, limiting. I mean, both sides, you know, Log kya kahenge, you know, ye paisa dega ki nahi wapas is one taboo which is running across. Nice. So what are your current workshops?
Right now, I'm working upon, you know, women's entrepreneurship. I am working upon mental health very, very strongly. And I'm also being associated with few people in and around the nation. So I'm positive that there is a lot of support coming in my way. And I'm sure there are a lot of helping hands who are going to support one another, including me. And the project is very big, very, very huge. So, you know, as a mental health coach, I'm also into soft skills training. I'm also into motivational training. I'm also into coaching. So there are a lot of the things that I'm focusing upon. And I'm trying to bring these women in a different stream and letting them know that they can always be a helping hand. They need to reach out to people, invest in small businesses. Even if it is like a 5K or a 10K or a 20K, I mean, money doesn't, you know, you don't have to literally invest in money in bulk to probably become rich or probably become successful. I feel very strongly because your hard work actually pays off end of the day.
So, Soha, we also want to know you. I mean, beyond a coach, beyond a person who's an angel who wants to come and help people who have, you know, mental health challenges. Or depressed. I mean, mental health, yahan pe, I mean, in India, mental health is pagal. I mean, we are not talking about pagalpan here. We are talking about mental health, which basically leads you to stress and depression. So if you have to use this term as mental health, that's fine. So let's not get into conclusions that mental health is about pagalpan. Ya agar pyar mein hum log pagal ho sakte hain, to life mein agar kuch pagalpan दिमाग में होता है, there is cure for it. There are people who are ready to help out, like Soha here. So please do reach out. That's the message for everybody.
Absolutely.
But yeah, Soha, we want to hear more about you as a person. So we have some few rapid fire questions for you. So are you all set?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. What does your name mean?
Moon. It means moon.
Moon.
Yes.
Okay. Do you have any special talents? If it is, what are they?
I'm an artist. I paint, I write, and I'm into a lot of other things like, you know, stitching. I'm an interior designer. I'm a fashion consultant. So, you know, life had actually come in a very, very different stream. I always wanted to be talented in all the streams. Because I remember my grandmom telling me that, beta, if you've got to, you know, get married to somebody and go into his family, they should not tell that you do not know nothing. So there is always a learning in life and you should never stop learning. So when I was very, very small, I got into, you know, artwork. I mean, I was into painting and all. I was raised and I probably was pushed into singing, though I'm a very bad singer. And yeah, and then, you know, I wanted to probably take up interior designing because I wanted to always make my house more beautiful. When people come, I always wanted everybody to look at it and say, wow, you know, she really maintained it well. But yeah, today I feel that's only because of me. I want to make it for myself, not for others.
So that wall behind you is your idea? That's your
design? Absolutely.
Okay.
And apart from that, I take in fashion designing because, you know, fashion consulting, because I probably wanted to look much better in my appearance when I'm meeting people around, because, you know, you're, as people say, that the first impression is the best. And I always wanted to focus upon that part because you not only, you know, meet people, but you meet people from different streams. I mean, people judge you by your face, though people say, no, you've got to go by heart. Dil dekho, shakal nahi dekho, but ye fact nahi hai. हम पहले एक दूसरे को देखते हैं, उसके बाद ही हम उसको जानते हैं. यू नो, यू देन गेट डीपर इनटू द पर्सन, नोइंग द पर्सन. सो इट्स डेफिनेटली द फर्स्ट अपीयरेंस एंड आई वांटेड टू गेट इनटू फैशन कंसल्टिंग एंड देन ह्यूमन रिसोर्सेज हैड बीन अ पार्ट. आईड बीन पार्ट ऑफ एचआर, आईड बीन अ पार्ट ऑफ यू नो लॉट अदर हैपनिंग. सो एचआर केम इनटू मी बिकॉज आई वांटेड टू फील दैट आई वांटेड टू प्रोबब्ली मेक अ चेंज इन समवन्स लाइफ. एज आई सेड, यू नो, आई वेरी स्ट्रांगली wanted to help people around me because I had faced a lot of problems. So yeah.
I think one of the strengths, the talents you should talk about is people. You're a people person. So I think
absolutely
that's my take on your profile.
People's person, yes, because I remember, you know, in my organization, anything would happen to anybody I was working with, of course. Everybody would like, Soha, where is she? And people would come, you know, running to me and discussing their problems. And that's how mental health actually came into me. And I thought I should probably help people because I am a good listener. I probably try listening to people. You know, what exactly happens is when this thing actually comes in is when you hear out people want to reach out to you. So the only thing you have to do is hearing them out. And that's the end of all the problems.
So
that's a little about
it. Make someone laugh.
Make someone
laugh. You know, if you're cracking a joke or something, what makes someone laugh?
Maybe funny faces, funny emoticons. That's it. I mean, laughing is just, it just comes, you know. I mean, I do not know what makes people laugh. I'm unsure about it. I laugh at anything. I mean, you know, once we went to a dhaba with my daughter and she happened to fell from a swing. And I started laughing and she was so upset about it. She was so upset about it. And she started looking at me and staring at me and saying, Mama, you know what? I fell down and you're laughing at me. And I'm like, no, the way you fell and the way, you know, the swing hit you was very funny. So
I have my brother-in-law who does the same thing. Anybody falls down, you know, even his mother falls down, you know, he first laughs. And then it takes like a couple of minutes. After that, he will, you know, give his helping hand. So, yeah, I am personally aware of a person who does this. Next question. Can you remember the most fun time you ever had? And where was it? And what were you doing?
Fun time I had was, I think, with one of my friend's uncle. You know, it was Shivratri. And we happened to go to their family because, you know, we wanted to probably be a part of the fasting and all. So when we went there, I remember that uncle happened to take some drink, whether it was Shivratri, very much close to that. I don't remember the festival. I'm unsure about it. I'm just trying to relate what was the festival. So I remember he taking a piece of a bread and he took it in his hand and he started saying, "Ye mera Taj Mahal hai." So that was the most hilarious moment because he was looking at the white part of it and he was thinking it's Taj Mahal. So, yeah.
Good. So
and another thing was like, you know, when I ventured out with my husband and we happened to go to this Leonia resort and he happened to fall into the swimming pool with so many people around him. And when he actually got out of the swimming pool, we could see him with bare anything. So, yeah.
So about you during your childhood, your school days, your college days, how were you? Were you the same, you know, bubbly, talkative, you know, a person who's always talking about life, fun, or was it a different side of you?
In my school days, I was very naughty. I mean, I remember initially I used to get hit by my friends and come home crying with my grandmother and saying to my grandmother that, you know what, Chaiji, I used to call her Chaiji. I used to say, Chaiji, she's hit me and, you know, I'm not able to take this because she's hit me real hard. And I was very, very tiny then. So my grandmother hit me again and she told me that, why did you, you know, have to hurt yourself with somebody who's hitting you so hard and you're coming back home and crying? Instead, hit her one and come back. So I remember next day I went with that courage, you know, because I knew that my support is, you know, behind me. And I went, I pulled her hair and I pulled it so back that, you know, I had a bunch of it in my hands.
Oh, shit.
And then the parent of that child happened to come back to the school complaining it to my princy. And my principal happened to call my grandmother again, ki aapki beti ne kya kara hai? And my grandmother said, agar usne mara hai, to isne bhi mara hai, to it's okay. So I actually, in my school, I was like a tomboy. In my college again, you know, I was really, really very, very naughty.
So college mein kitne logon ko mara hai?
College mein bahuton ko mara hai. I remember there was a guy in my college, he was a senior, you know, in the college and he wanted to make friends. So instead of coming to me and directly, he thought I'm very, you know, snobbish. He thought that I wouldn't open up or talk to anybody. I would just take the books in my bag and just rush to my friends. And that was the story. But that was not the story. I was very friendly and, you know, I always believed in life. And, you know, that's the reason I kept telling, you know, failures never hit me bad, though I was depressed or whatever. But I'd always come back to life. So this guy happened to, you know, take some caterpillars in a huge long, I do not know what, twig. And I was sitting in my class near the window and he happened to put that twig on my back. And all those caterpillars falling on my back and I had a very, very, you know, bad rash. And then I happened to, you know, ask my friends, ki, you know, who did it? I'm not able to see the person. So they happened to tell me this is the guy and he did it. So I rushed to him outside the class. The class was going on. Without even taking an excuse, I just rushed to him and I held him and I hit him so bad.
Yeah, that is
and later I asked him, sorry?
Yeah, that's definitely not an acceptable behavior by him. So that's very
Yeah,
odd.
so right. And even if somebody would actually, you know, happen to stare or anything also, I was always very open and asking ki what's your problem and things like that. तो बहुतों को पीटा है.
Okay, what is the difference between stress and depression in your own words?
Yeah, stress is basically a part of life which happens every single day with small little issues also. For example, your daughter's not getting ready or not bathing in time, that is a stress. She's not eating in time is a stress. Your husband going out and not coming home in time is stress. He's you know, on a bike and or in a car and you're worried about him that what is really wrong, it's raining outside, he's not picking your call is stress. You know, people probably sometimes not coming to you and meeting you up is a stress. You keep inviting, they don't come. That is also every small little thing I find is a stress nowadays. People take it as a stress. Depression is when you go deeper in thinking a lot. That is basically when you are not very happy about life, when you feel that you're very lonely and people are not really helping you, and where you are trying to, you know, get away from everybody, sitting alone, binge eating, sleeping a lot. Not talking to anybody, not opening up at all, or maybe binge watching, or probably, you know, sobbing yourself, not opening up. And that is depression. Depression leads you to get cut from your social life.
Okay.
So depression is very deep. Depression is when a person actually goes to extremes of doing anything at all. Sometimes it's minute, sometimes it is very easy and you can just come out of it by talking to people, and sometimes you need to be medicated for it.
Cool. So, what is the funniest corporate or business screw up that you've heard about? You know, might be while you're working, or might be, you know, one of the workshops you were doing at corporates. You would have heard about this particular story.
Goof up.
Screw up. It can be screw up done by somebody, which is
Or
the
me.
most funniest thing.
I do not know about any screw ups as such as of now, because you know I haven't come across any as such, though I kept reading somewhere, but then I wouldn't want to mention that. Screw up, I could actually say it just happened few minutes back where we were, you know, trying to connect and things weren't really getting connected. So I should say that was the biggest thing. I mean, this has never happened ever.
Yeah, it's raining heavily, friends. So that's the reason, you know, we joined in late, and yeah, you see the
In
video
fact,
quality.
I'm continuously getting messages on my WhatsApp that we want to connect and are you live? So I'm not understanding how do I message them because I'm right now, you know, talking with you. So I do want to connect with them, but I'm unsure how.
Yeah, just ask your family members to share that stream. I think we're good. They'll be able to see it on your page.
Yeah, great. So I
Okay.
if my family is listening.
Are drugs or therapy better in mental health conditions? Which
Sorry?
one you prefer? Do you prefer drugs or therapy? Which is
Therapy.
better for mental health?
I very strongly believe drugs are a big no-no. See, I tell you what, basically, when anybody is given drugs, so the main concern out here is that the person happens to sleep for 16 to 18 hours a day. So the first thing, what happens is they are cut off socially. So they are no more social animals, and that makes them more depressed. If the mental condition is very, very strong, is when I recommend that you need to go and meet a psychiatrist. But until then, I suggest you be with the psychologist, because they can hear you out and give you a lot of therapies. And trust me, Ravi, nowadays there are a lot of alternative therapies which are happening in and around us, where people are by, you know, mindfulness, by meditation, by yoga, by sort of crystal therapy and, you know, self-healing, self-talk. There are a lot of other therapies, music therapy, stone therapy. You know, these are some therapies which people are venturing out in and trying to come out of their mental issues. And I very strongly believe that one needs to talk it out, and we are open to the discussions, and they can be rest assured that this would be within us and them. So nobody else, not even their family. So I feel that you should reach out to a.
Yeah, we see some echo coming in here.
Yeah, even now. That's the reason I had to stop. So I probably feel that you should reach out for therapies rather than getting into medications. Medications are a big no-no. Anytime.
Okay. Well, what are the basic things you suggest in our day-to-day activity? See, these are things, you know, we are talking about which happens. You know, what if you come to a stage where you feel that you're depressed or you're stressed and, you know, overstressed and, you know, you feel that you're getting into depression, we're looking at solution. But what are the common changes which we can do to our daily lifestyle where we're not getting there, we're not reaching there? So do you have any suggestions where we're not going to that extreme and, you know, it's like prevention is better than cure?
I strongly believe that the first thing they get up in the morning is about what they eat. You know, it's very important about how you live your life. For example, you know, when you get up in the morning, you hit a gym or you go out or you probably go for a walk or for a jog or maybe get into yoga or some sort of meditation. That's the most important part of it because, you know, that keeps you fit, that keeps your mind healthy. And then you have to be probably mindful about what you're eating in the morning. Generally, you know, people skip their breakfast and nowadays it's intermittent dieting and people are also working out on such dietings and they are, as I said, you know, alternative ways of living life. So what is that you're eating? You need to eat mindfully. And then apart from that, whenever you feel that you want to just stay alone, I recommend very strongly that surround yourself with friends and family. Do not sit alone. Do not try binge watching. Do not try binge eating. Do not try sleeping and getting away from this particular syndrome or believing in that, you know, I do not feel like talking to anybody. I do not feel like reaching out to anybody because this happens with a lot of people who are falling into depression. The first thing they would actually do is come out of it. They try to get out of the people. So that's the most saddest part. And it's very important that one has a me time.
Yeah.
Very, very important. One has a me time. See, I'll tell you what. Your me time is so essential for a person to realize that he's been a champion by himself. He's fought all those battles right from the time. You know, I'd always believe that there is a journey of a person which begins in the womb and ends at the tomb. So your fight, your battle begins in the womb. When you're just, you know, a speck. And you're probably fighting it out all with those sperms inside which are actually trying to have a little life. And you're the one who's actually fought for yourself in the stomach of your mother, in the womb. And what happened when you actually grow, when you're grown? What happened to that particular hero who was actually fighting inside is not able to fight outside? You know, it's easier said than done. I completely believe in it. It's easier said than done. But then... Yeah, I mean, but then I feel like if you start exercising and believing in yourself, start exercising and fighting it for you and talking it out to people. And it's absolutely okay, as I said, you know, I mean, if you are not feeling okay, if you're not feeling good, if you're not feeling healthy, if you're not fine, it is absolutely okay. Depression is a part of, you know, everybody at one point in time have faced depression. Knowingly or unknowingly, they did. Now it has become a very huge word in the market that this person is in depression, this person is in mental health. I don't remember my grandmother telling this ever to me or my mother telling this ever to me that we are in some sort of depression and, you know, we are fighting the loneliness or we need time and all because they were always busy in their own lives and schedule and they did not have this word depression. Now, because the word had actually been so much into the market, that I think each and every individual probably is into it and we feel that they are depressed or some of the other problem.
I agree. So we have another question from Jitesh. He's basically asking, hey Zoha, do you see, I mean, good to see you here. Sorry, it's taking some time for me to read because it's very tiny. Have been your most common and dominant observation among people which need a big course correction in terms of their behavior and attitude, which would help the population towards greater reasons?
I did not get the question clearly.
Maybe I've not read it properly. What has been your most common and dominant observation among people which needs a big course correction?
I feel that people are too much busy with their own lives. That's been a biggest observation. People are only thinking of in the perspective of their own families. People do not want to extend that helping hand to one another. And I think you have come into this world for a purpose. And the purpose needs to be filled by each individual. And you are beings. So you need to support each other. You need to think beyond your family also.
Yeah, I
So
think
that's
adding
the
to
biggest
this, I also feel so what happens is, in this particular rat race, we want to be better than our neighbor. We want to be better in terms of our cousins. We want to have a better lifestyle compared to anybody else in our family. So here, I think the major issue starts here. Things are good, but we somewhere realize we have to realize that it's not always Friday. So there are some bad days. There are recessions. There are pandemics where things can slow down. I think this is where when things go wrong, we actually have a very hard fall because our expectations are very high, our targets are very high, and anything happens in the race in between, we have a very hard fall. I think one of the reason is that, I mean, that's my opinion because I've seen, at a certain stage, if you ask me, I sometimes feel that, okay, I have to sell all of this, all the properties and all that I have, go to Himalayas, have a small hut, live there. I think life would be much more lesser stressful, where I don't have so many transactions. Ye plumbing nahi gaya, wo plumber nahi aaya, ye electrical ka damage hai, this maintenance, that maintenance. It's better to, and I think a certain segment of people should just give up and say that, hey, it's okay. I'm living a simple life. I am okay living in a rented house for my entire life. I'm okay living in a village, just work for like 7,000 or 8,000 rupees per month, but still live a happy life, have more time for our family.
To think like that, it's very insane in today's zamana. I should actually talk about it. It is absolutely insane. I should tell you that a person who really wants to leave everything, go and live on Himalayas also will be stressful. There he will have different reasons. There he'll have different reasons. It's your mindset. It's your mindset. What is that you're laminating on your mind? What is that you're actually thinking about your life around you? Your life is yours, right? I mean, so you can live it anywhere the way you want to be. It's not just about going to Himalayas and then getting that relief and getting that mindfulness in you. The only I feel very strongly that if you decide to be happy, nobody can stop you off.
Yeah, so
So
it
what
doesn't, it's not location based, so
it is
it is
not.
not where you are. Okay.
It is completely here. I'd seen a video very recently of this girl called Arunima Sinha. The first amputee to climb Mount Everest. So she says that I'm not handicapped here, and I'm handicapped by my body. That is my, legs. She doesn't have her legs. She's an amputee, and she walked all through Mount Everest. So she's delivered this, and she very beautifully delivered that. It's very, very important that one needs to be mentally fit, mentally strong, and that is more important.
Cool. So, any questions from friends? Feel free to add on. In the meanwhile, I have some questions for you. So, what is a personality disorder? Is that different than mental health, or is it different from being stressed or depressed?
It is absolutely different from mental health and the stress we are talking about. That disorder is about a person's ability to understand and follow others. So it's a
Okay.
completely different thing.
Okay. So even they have to seek help of a psychologist first.
Yes.
The process is.
Mental health disorder needs to go to the doctors first to understand what is the disorder. There are many types of disorders when it comes to what you're talking about. Mental health is a completely different thing, and personality disorder, they have to probably go to a psychiatrist and a psychologist to find out what is the disorder all about, because they're taught there are many disorders in that. Yeah, there are many variants of disorders actually. Yeah.
So, what are the small things a corporate or a small business can do to ensure that, see, one of the major challenges, how do you recognize a person who is depressed or, going through mental health issues? So, what are the steps? First, corporates. Second, friends around. What are the ways you can recognize that this person is, undergoing depression or, should needs attention so that they can act on it?
So the
Because
initial part of
even the corporates have this issue. So it's a reputation. Some good brands, some MNC, the employees commit suicide. The equal liability also goes to the corporate because the company might be blamed where he was going through stressful job hours or stress at work. And a similar case might be with family members and friends. So the blame can go on with somebody. So what do you suggest? How do we get to know that this person is? What are the indications? What are the signals?
The first indication about them is that they get completely disconnected with others. They become too sensitive. You talk to even if you're just trying to tell something, they immediately get into tears. So the first is that they disconnect from others. They do not want to be a part of the society. They do not want to socialize. So that is a huge disconnect, and you can actually find that a person who's absolutely jovial, laughing, and around everybody, trying to help, support, suddenly becomes very quiet. Suddenly he's trying to detach himself with you, and there is definitely they avoid gatherings around them, and they do not want to be a part of socializing at all. So that is the biggest sign. You can immediately find out that this is a problem with them.
Okay. And in a workplace, what about in a workplace? How do you handle that? Corporate.
Workplace, see, it is very difficult for a person to handle that, but then I think the HRs can take this person one-on-one and talk it out with them. If the HRs are into the psychology of it also, because nowadays there is HR psychology which is taught into many colleges, and many HRs have already done it as a course, so they can individually take them and have a one-on-one with them. Or maybe somebody in the office, most of the things and learnings you have is over the cup of coffee. So maybe somebody from the office can take an initiative in talking it out and telling them that, hey, you know what, I'm seeing some changes, and is there anything that I can do to help you? Instead of saying, I can understand your situation. It is his situation. Nobody can understand his situation. Nobody. It is impossible. We keep telling people that, oh, I'm in your, I, if I were in your shoes, I would have done this. Nobody can do that. Saying is very easy. We can actually tell them 100 things, but it's only we who are it's only he who's facing it, or she who's facing it. So instead of saying, you know what, I can understand, say, I'm here to listen. Do not give them solutions when they are talking about the problems. I think you should only listen to them, because what happens is, end of the day, this in corporate especially, the productivity hampers. The only thing which affects the most is the productivity. The person is not concentrating, he's not able to, give his 100% into the office. He's going back home, he's not ready to, work at home as well. He's just completely disconnected from work and home together. So I think end of the day, somebody has to probably go to them and telling them that they are there to help them out, or listen to them at least. So reach them out. And reaching them out is probably very, very important.
Okay, so on a lighter note, who's your favorite hero, actor, actress, your favorite songs?
My favorite hero, the first hero of my life, was my dad. And then I also tell that my husband is my favorite hero, but then
Oh,
the actual favorite
we need celebrities' names.
hero. I know, that's the reason I'm coming to the celebrity part of it.
So
So
third person, yeah, third hero.
The third hero. I'd always liked Anil Kapoor.
Okay.
He's one of my favorite heroes. There are many favorite heroes for different reasons. I like Anil Kapoor because, you know, I'd always seen him with that Dhina Din Tha and that kind of, you know, energy he displays whenever
Energy.
he comes across. He still looks very young and more better than anybody, any young actor today in the industry. And then I
True.
like Shah Rukh Khan for his, you know, personality, because he's so much a connect with people, you know, he's very, very good with people. So I feel he's got that particular connect. And then Salman Khan, of course, has been a heartthrob. And my love for him can never actually stop because of the being he is, you know, such helpful human. And I don't know, I mean, how do I relate? But then I find him not only good looking, but I also find him very good and kind by his heart. So that's the amalgamation. That's the connect of face and you know, heart together.
Heroines.
Many again, you know, I like Shobhana from the Telugu industry. I like Madhubala, of course, she's no more. Madhuri Dixit, yes, because of her expressions, you know, when she dances and when she acts. So in one step, she can have like 10 expressions happening together. And then Aditi Haidari. So there's so many. I mean, there are so many. And if we have to talk about the Telugu industry, I remember there was I think she's not into acting anymore. Madhavi. So she was again one of my favorites. So yeah.
Cool. Well, what's
and
your favorite?
I like her for her color the most, actually.
Oh, Madhavi.
Yeah. Madhavi, yeah. She you know, when I saw her in the movie, she was very dusky, yet so attractive. Yeah.
So what's your favorite ice cream flavor?
Strawberry and banana from Baskin and Robbins. Baskin 31 Robbins. Because I grew up eating that.
So what is that one thing which you're really missing during this pandemic?
Actually, nothing. In fact, I'm gaining a lot of things in this pandemic. You know, there was so much of learning. Trust me, it was always a one-on-one. It was always by person that I was, you know, interacting. But I've learned so many online apps. I'm trying to use my mobile. I'm trying to become a gadget, you know, guru myself. Trying to learn a lot of activities like trying to get into AI, trying to learn what is Java, trying to understand what is software actually going to, how is software going to help me, and trying to understand the new generation now, the Generation Z and Generation I. Trying to understand how can I probably fit the bill of being a mental health advisor or an architect. Trying to relate to more people online. Trying to connect to most of the people I've never connected all these while because I had no time to connect. But now I'm trying to connect to each individual, whether they're US, from India, from anywhere. I'm just trying to make a call and like, okay, is everything fine? And the connections come back. You know, the botherations come back, the relationships come back, the life has come back, love has come back. So I think pandemic had actually taught me to live my life once again.
Cool. So what is the most weirdest thing you've done in your life, if you have to recollect, like 20 years down the line, you have to look back at your life. Most notorious or weird thing that you've done in life, which you can confidently tell your grandkids, saying that ye maine kiya tha.
The weirdest
thing. Thanks for meeting you guys in your school and college. That's already covered.
The weirdest thing I'd actually done, I should say, was never learned cooking. And the weirdest food I'd ever made was prawns. I thought I would actually fry them and make them very yummy. My mouth is actually watering thinking about it. But then I really couldn't relate whether I cooked prawns in salt or salt was cooked in prawns.
Yeah.
So that was the weirdest thing I'd ever done. And there was nothing else which I'd actually done which was very weird, apart from cooking. So I am very bad at cooking. I do not cook at all. And if any time I experiment, I am not sure if I have an ambulance standing outside my house. Yeah.
So how do you manage at home? Like,
I don't manage, actually. It's it's that my daughter has become my mother. So she's the one who's taking it up. She's taking care. Husband, of course, has been playing a very important role in explaining me why cooking is very important, but yet he's giving up every time he tells me that, because I end up saying, why don't you try a little, you know, and that's very tough. So I have a cook at home, and yeah.
Yeah. So your daughter behaves like your mom or your granny?
My mom, not my granny. She's very sweet. She's very kind and very, very humble being. And she's exactly opposite of what I am. I talk a lot. She doesn't talk at all.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if you are left out in an island for a month with no access to people, what are two things you definitely need there to survive?
On an island, of course, food and life.
Okay. And what is that you will do there the entire day?
I would experiment on a lot of things, you know. I would just venture out. In fact, it's actually so much good to be away from the world for an entire month and then be yourself. So I'll find myself.
Okay. So will you start searching for, you know, ways and means to get out of the island, or you would sit there and relish your 1 month?
I would relish my 1 month. There is no doubt that I would want to come out of it, sure. Because, you know, you need people be very dangerous. So I would want to come out, but that one whole month, I would only focus on just being happy, searching for new things, understanding what's life at the island and how, you know, you can survive. Yeah.
Cool. Good. That finishes the rapid fire questions, but we still have some questions which you might want to answer after we go, you know, offline.
Great.
So now the main question. So, here, there is a small modification with the question this time. So, you become the chief minister for 4 years, okay, and you have 1 minute to answer on the areas you would focus on. And you also have 1 lakh to spend for women empowerment. What are the areas you would focus on, and how would you spend this 1 lakh rupees, which you have to spend in like 24 hours? Immediately, 24 hours, you have to discuss this amount on women empowerment.
I would first of all conduct a program, investing in that particular money on that particular program, calling in people, advertising, saying that, you know, we are here to give a women empowerment coaching to every woman. I would call them in. So it would be all on social media. And then, of course, the place I would be venturing out to have this program, I would call in the women and tell them how important it is to probably, you know, stand on their feet and probably work on themselves rather than working on the family. See, because if a woman is actually not disturbed by what is happening across her, of course, it is, you know, a part of family. So they would be quite disturbed. And happiness is something which is missing in most of the women today, because I think the responsibilities have grown. So I would, in fact, teach them how to respond with ability in my program.
Yes.
So if I have to, yeah, if I have to probably split responsibility, I would say response with ability. And I think every individual, not just women, every individual can do that. Just that they need to tap into the right person to probably teach them, train them and coach them, saying that this is what they have to do. And they just need to, life is a learning. And I think every particular part of their life, they can learn out of one another. Another part I would tap into would be the hygiene and education, of course, also the police reforms.
Good.
Yeah, very important, because I see that, you know, the people around, especially, you know, the government, which has the police, which has legal, they have all the authorities in their hand, are most of the times, you know, exploiting it. You know, when you go to US, you see the cops coming to you, and if you're sitting in a bus station or you're stuck somewhere, you know, I'd seen them coming in asking, are you okay, mate? Is everything okay, mate? And are you fine? Is there anything that we could help you? I wish, you know, we can change that in India too. And I had not seen anybody actually coming out to us, reaching out to us and saying, in fact, they look at us in a way that we get scared of them. we do not want to talk to them. We get away thinking ki are pata nahi, you know, what would he talk, what would he say, and how would he react to things. And I would certainly be looking out for, you know, creating more friendly neighboring countries across us as a chief minister.
Good points, Soha. So that's all we have for the session. Thanks for taking time out. Lovely background. Lovely
Thank
thoughts.
You.
And, you know, a lovely way of thinking. I think the way you're thinking, and I'm sure, you know, many can get benefited while once they talk to you. So I would suggest all the friends who are new to Soha, do connect with her. I have shared her page. Do connect with her workshops. She does a lot of live workshops now, but otherwise she does a lot of workshops in corporates and colleges. So, Soha, I'll also be part of one of your sessions, because I think this time is not enough and we need to connect more. So I'll
Absolutely.
Definitely love to be part of your sessions to hear more of you. So,
in fact,
thank
I'm
you.
Honored to be a part of 1 Minute CM. I should be admitting this, that you're doing a wonderful job, Ravi. You know, reaching out through people and reaching out to people and through people, of course, calling into people and, you know, giving them also an opportunity to reach out the market, to do something better for the market and or the people around. And, you know, that's very humble of you. I find that humility in you, and I'm sure that you would also reach places with what you're doing. I wish you all the very best, and may God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, Soha. That's so nice of you. Trying to do my best, and I'm sure, you know, this will have value for everybody who views it, and also people who are being the guest here.
Absolutely. So, and thank you so much to the guests and the viewers who had to bear us for almost like 40 minutes from the time we logged in. I appreciate everybody here, and I'm sure that if anybody wants to connect and associate, you can reach out to Ravi, and he would be letting you my email IDs or my, you know, phone numbers or whatever you want to. And I'm sure Ravi is also one of the ones who would want to help you out, and being a kind being. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, friends. So you know, when next time you meet Soha, you have what flavor of ice cream you have to family pack, you have to take it to her. So, but yeah, nice connecting, and you know, we will meet in person, Soha. I'm eagerly waiting for that. Lovely weather
sure.
here, but yeah, we had some internet interruptions. Thank you, friends, for
Absolutely.
Joining here. Have a great
Thank
evening
you.
Ahead. Thank you, Soha. Bye.
Thank you. Take care.